Hachette Audio presents Every Man a King, a short, colorful history of American populists, written and read by Chris Stirewalt.
My dearest Newman and Arthur, you have given your time and sacrificed my attention for this project. You have also, even without knowing it, helped me work out these ideas. Keeping this republic will be your job, not mine. My generation is something of a historical pass-through in our country, bridging eras of momentous change. You are the ones who will get to decide what to do with this inheritance, the last best hope of Earth. Knowing you, I could not be more pleased with our chances. Gratefully, your loving father. I've saved the lives of little children. I've sent men through college. I've lifted communities from the mud. I've cured insane people. Louisiana Senator Huey Long, in an interview with James Thurber for The New Yorker, August 1933. Introduction. There is something absolutely American about the notion that you, my friends, are getting screwed royally. The fix was in even before you got here. So at least it's not your fault. In fact, you should count yourself lucky that you are one of the discerning few who understand how things really are. And there's probably nothing you can do about it. Unless... The political idea that we now know as American populism is older than the republic itself, and certainly greeted that same republic with suspicion. Merchants and planters and elites conspired against you, even before they gathered in Philadelphia to draft the charter for these United States. Out in that same twilight space where legitimate concern still brushes past conspiracy theory, the proto-populists were already nodding knowingly. As Bertrand Russell put it, from the time of Jefferson onward, the doctrine that all men are equal applies only upwards, not downwards. Or, as one of populism's most vivid apostles, Huey Long, would more succinctly say, every man a king. This energy has manifested itself in both parties and in various political ideologies over the centuries. Conservatism, liberalism, nationalism, socialism, and even out-and-out bigotry. But one constant has always been the fascinating assortment of charismatic leaders, characters, crooks, cranks, and sometimes charlatans who have, with widely varying degrees of success, led the charge of ordinary folks who have gotten wise to the ways of the swamp. The depths of despair and heights of exhilaration with which Americans greeted the ascendance and presidency of Donald Trump were partly rooted in the idea that it was something altogether new. We've never seen anything like it before, they said. But if you tug on one golden thread of Trump's presidential seal, you will find a cord running all the way back to the beginning of us. Populist politicians have sometimes bedeviled us, sometimes saved us, but always fascinated us. And to understand our moment and what is likely to descend from it, we would do well to know some of those who have stormed the parapet before our current president made it over the top. And as we come to understand these men, we also see that their successes and failures spring from the same common traits and relied on some common circumstances in the republic and its people. Every successful American politician has some blend of democratic zeal and republican restraint. Our first partisan split, a clash between the factions of Thomas Jefferson and Alexander Hamilton, wasn't a struggle between opposing views as much as it was a conflict over emphasis and always, always, always personalities. Jefferson's idea of holding regular constitutional conventions might rightly be described as a perfectly republican idea. It's certainly a more populist concept than the permanent but amendable charter we ended up with, but Jefferson's automatic conventions would have most certainly made clear the primacy of the Constitution. There's a reason why the party he founded once held both Democratic and Republican in its name, you know. Similarly, Hamilton owes his 21st century vogue not to his sometimes breathtakingly elitist attitudes, like a non-hereditary kingship, but to his embrace of a culture of upward mobility and his vision of an activist, technocratic federal government. That, and Lin-Manuel Miranda's ability to rhyme with Rochambeau. Conservatives now mainly see the Constitution as a means to constrain the federal Leviathan, while today's liberals tend to focus on the Charter's guarantees of individual rights. So it's understandable that modern Americans are prone to forget that the purpose of the document was to create a central government more powerful than all but a few of the revolutionary generation would have initially envisioned. We believe now, as they did in the summer of 1787, that rightful government aims to produce the proper balance between freedom and order, so that people are free to achieve their fullest potential. The tyranny of a despot and the tyranny of the mob are different in style, but commensurate in their power to oppress and destroy. In excess, both freedom and order can produce oppression. In equipoise, they produce miracles. America's prosperity and progress toward equal freedom under the law probably owes more to our culture than to our government. We are not free because the government says so, but rather because we the people have been mostly able stewards of these historically unprecedented blessings. But even the strongest culture needs guardrails to provide predictability and keep us from veering too far from our objective of maximizing freedom and opportunity. When our culture and government are both healthy, their traits are complementary. But when either proves deficient, they can help prop each other up and help correct the maladies in one another. James Madison was the founding father who would ultimately strike the balance between the young Jefferson's belief in the sovereignty of the commoners and Hamilton's desire for a federal government of real sovereign power. He was the one who best explained the way a government could be powerful enough to provide adequate security and protect individual liberty without becoming tyrannical itself. Ambition must be made to counteract ambition. By balancing powers between small-d democratic institutions, such as the House, with small-r republican ones like the Supreme Court, the founders created the governmental equivalent of a self-cleaning oven. There would be the rule of law to counteract popular excesses and popular sentiment to act against the abuses of the law. The opponents of the Constitution, the anti-federalists, considered the argument a betrayal of the revolutionary spirit. At the debate in Richmond over ratifying the Charter, Patrick Henry, the same man who had goaded his reluctant fellow Virginians into rebellion, led the charge against a strong central government. "Will the abandonment of your most sacred rights tend the security of your liberty?" he asked. "Liberty, the greatest of all earthly blessings, give us that precious jewel and you may take everything else." Give him liberty or give him... But in Federalist No. 45, Madison argues convincingly for a constitution that would expand the reach of the federal government at the expense of the powers and autonomy of state governments. Madison explains that the rights, well-being, and happiness of the people supersede the more abstract rights the anti-federalists said they meant to protect. "We have heard of the impious doctrine in the old world, that the people were made for kings, not kings for people," he wrote. "Is the same doctrine to be revived in the new, in another shape, that the solid happiness of the people is to be sacrificed to the views of political institutions of a different form?" Simply put, the purpose of the Republic is not to maintain small-r republicanism. Rather, a republican system is what history and our own experiences have shown to best temper the impulses of the electorate while still keeping the government accountable to the electorate's demands. The people can have what they want, but the process moves slowly because no branch of government can rule alone. If republicanism did not obtain the greatest portion of contentment for the greatest number of our people, we would long ago have scrapped it. You have probably heard the old saw about thanking God for unanswered prayers. I certainly count as a blessing having not obtained many of the things that I, as a boy and young man, desperately wanted. And for other things, having to work and want for seeming eternities made me more grateful and better prepared to enjoy, steward, and exploit them. Just as it's good that we as individuals don't get everything that we want when we want it, it has proven to be overwhelmingly good that the American people's demands have sometimes been denied and are almost always delayed. America didn't need petty fascism in the 1930s.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.